Thomas the Tank Engine was feeling bright and cheerful. It was a splendid day.
Good morning.
He whistled to some cows, but the cows didn't reply.
Never mind,
said Thomas.
They're busy with their breakfast.
Next, he saw Birdie.
Hello, Birdie. Care for a race today?
But all Birdie could say was, Ouch! That's another hole in the road.
I'm sorry, Birdie,
smiled Thomas. Thomas was still in good spirits when Birdie arrived at the next station.
Bad luck, Birdie. Now, if you're a steam engine, you will run a pair of reliable rails.
Huh, replied Birdie. The railway is supposed to deliver the tar to mend the road 2 weeks ago. You can't trust a thing that runs on rails.
I run on rails. You can trust me, Birdie. I'll see if I can find out what's happened.
And Thomas puffed away towards the big station. James was snorting about in the yard.
It's too bad, he grumbled. Percy goes to work at the harbor and I do his job here, there, and everywhere. Take that!
Oh, groaned the freight car.
Just you wait. We'll show you.
Gordon laughed.
I'll tell you what, James. If you pretend to ill, you couldn't shut freight cars here or go to the quarry there, could you?
What a good idea,
agreed James.
Look, here comes Thomas. I'll start pretending now.
Thomas was sorry to see the engines looking miserable.
Cheer up. It's a beautiful day.
Yes, grumbled Gordon, but not for James.
What's the matter?
He's sick, replied Gordon.
Yes, he is. I mean, I am,
stuttered James.
I don't feel well at all.
Don't worry,
said Thomas kindly.
I'll help out if you're ill.
Gordon and James snickered quietly to each other. Some of James's cars were coupled behind Thomas, and he steamed away to the quarry. The cars were still cross.
We couldn't pay James back for bumping us, so we'll play tricks on Thomas instead. One engine is as good as another.
But Thomas didn't hear them. He collected all the stone from the quarry and set off back to the junction. Danger lay ahead.
Now for our plan, giggled the cars. Go faster, go faster.
They pushed Thomas over the switches. Slow down, called Thomas the driver and applied the brakes. Poor Thomas stood dazed and surprised in a muddy pond as a toad eyed him suspiciously.
Buff my buffers,
mumbled Thomas.
The day started so well, too.
Duck pulled away the cars, and Edward helped Thomas back to the junction. Suddenly, Thomas remembered the missing tar. He told Edward all about it.
That's strange, said Edward. A car full of tar has been left at my station. That must be it. Driver will make sure it gets to Birdie now.
Later, James spoke to Thomas.
I'm sorry about your accident,
he muttered.
And so is Gordon. We didn't mean to get you into trouble.
No, indeed, spluttered Gordon. A mere misunderstanding, Thomas. All's well that ends well.
Just then, Birdie arrived. He looked much more cheerful.
My road's been mended now.
Oh, I am glad,
replied Thomas.
Thanks for all you did, added Birdie. Now I know I can trust an engine, especially if his name is Thomas.
Gordon and James puffed silently away to the shed, but Thomas still had company.
Well, well,
he sighed.
What a day for surprises.
The toad, who was looking forward to a ride home, noisily agreed.
It was the summer festival on the island of Sodor, and everyone was celebrating. There was going to be a fireworks party in the evening. All the engines had special jobs, and they were all very excited. Sir Topham Hatt came to see Thomas.
Thomas,
You are to collect a new barbecue grill and take it to the humble man's summer house. He is celebrating his annual barbecue party. The girl must get there before dark, and the guests will have their meal.
Yes, sir,
said Thomas, and he puffed quickly away before it gets dark. Thomas starts to daydream about the big party. There will be clowns, the choir will be singing, and there will be a wonderful display of fireworks. Thomas puffed quickly to the warehouse. He was very excited. Thomas collected the barbecue grill. Thomas, said the yard manager, you better be careful. The track to the summer house is very bumpy. You must go slowly and carefully.
Yes, sir,
whistled Thomas, and he puffed as carefully as he could. Thomas slowed down at every bend, and he puffed carefully through every junction. Thomas stopped at the signal. Nia and Emily were there. They were very excited.
I can't wait for the fireworks,
said Emily.
The fireworks are going to start when it gets dark,
added Nia. Thomas wanted to be back in time to see the fireworks, but the summer house was on the other side of the island. It was a long way, and it would take him a long time to get there. Then, Thomas had an idea.
If I go just a little faster, the grill won't be able to fall off my flatbed,
he chuffed. And so, Thomas speeded up just a little. Thomas puffed along. He saw James at the water tower. James had trucks and trucks of fireworks.
This is going to be the biggest fireworks party ever, whistled James happily.
Now Thomas wanted to see the fireworks even more.
I'm sure I can go just a little faster,
he chuffed. So Thomas speeded up just a little more. Thomas puffed faster still. The grill started to rattle and shake on the fifth flatbed. Every time Thomas met another engine, he became more and more excited. Rebecca puffed along with trucks of ice cream and fizzy drinks.
It's going to be a wonderful party,
whistled Rebecca. Thomas went a little faster. Then he met Toby with the coconut shy. See you at the fireworks party, Thomas, he arranged. Thomas went a little faster. Then he saw Percy with children in fancy dress. The children were very excited.
See ya, Thomas,
called the children. Now Thomas wanted to be back at the party more than ever. Before he knew it, he was coming very fast. Then there was trouble. Harvey was replacing some tracks. The workmen had put a barrier across the track to warn the engines, but Thomas was going much too fast to stop safely. He bashed into the barrier, and the barbecue grill fell off his flatbed and crashed. Thomas looked at the grill. It was broken.
Thinner than ashes,
cried Thomas.
If the operator doesn't get his barbecue grill on time, the guests will be very disappointed.
Thomas knew what he must do. Thomas puffed back to the warehouse to collect a new barbecue grill. He knew now he would be too late to see the fireworks. On the way, Thomas stopped at the signal. Edward was waiting there and he was very excited.
I'm off to collect the Chinese dragon, he tooted.
But all Thomas could think about was getting the new barbecue grill. With the new grill safely on board, Thomas set off slowly and carefully. He knew he must deliver this grill safely to the summer house. So when Nia puffed by with the choir, who were practicing their song, and when Edward puffed by with the Chinese dragon, Thomas didn't think about the fireworks party at all. He had an important job to do. Thomas arrived at the summer house just in time. The girl was quickly unloaded.
Thank you, Thomas,
said the humble man. But Thomas was sad because he knew he had missed the fireworks party completely.
What's wrong, Thomas?
Asked the humble man.
I missed the fireworks,
upset, Thomas.
I've been looking forward to this, but now I'm not now.
It's okay, Thomas. But if you like a party, you could be my guest of honor barbecue party.
Oh, wow! I would love to do that, sir.
Soon, the barbecue party was a great success. All the guests had arrived, and the meal was lovely. But even though they didn't have rockets or gathering wheels, Thomas thought the barbecue looked wonderful as the fireworks. Thomas the Tank Engine and his friends were very excited. The fair was in town. All the engines in the yard wanted to go, but there was too much work to do. So only one engine could be spared. Sir Topham Hatt chose Henry to go to the fair and give the children rides.
I wish I could go to the fair,
said Thomas. You're in luck, his driver said. We have to bring some coal back to the station. You can see the fair along the way.
Beep, beep,
said Thomas. Thomas chugged along his tracks. Soon, he was at the fair. There were many things to see and do. He saw a marching band, a petting zoo with lots of animals, and children playing games. And there was Henry with coaches full of children ready to take a ride. Henry blew his whistle when he saw Thomas. Peep, peep, peep! Thomas chugged to the coal mine. He loaded his freight cars with coal and headed for home. Suddenly, dark clouds rolled in. Big raindrops fell from the sky. Everyone at the fair ran for cover. The rain fell harder and harder. Henry hated being wet. His driver unhooked him from his coaches. Then he backed Henry into the tunnel to stay dry. When the rain stopped, Henry was ready to come out of his tunnel. He tried and tried, but he couldn't move. His back wheels were stuck in the mud. Sir Topham Hatt didn't know what to do. Just then, Thomas chugged by on his way back to the station. His driver saw the crowd standing around Henry. He went over to see what was going on. Thank goodness you've come, said Sir Topham Hatt. Henry is stuck. We need an engine to give the children rides. Thomas felt bad for his friend Henry, but he was happy to be able to help. Quickly, the workmen hooked Henry's coaches onto Thomas. Everyone cheered, hooray for Thomas! And everyone had a good time.
He's a really useful engine, you know. All the other engines, they'll tell you so. He huffs and puffs and whistles, rushing to and fro. He's a really useful engine we adore. He's the one, he's the one. He's a really useful engine that we adore. He's the one, he's the number one. Dollars, the tank engine.
He's the one, he's the one, he's the really useful engine that we adore. He's the one, he's the number one, Thomas the Tank Engine. Little Blue Train is always there whenever you need a hand. If you need help with the situation, who comes into mind?
He's the one, he's the one. He's the really useful engine that we adore. He's the one, he's the number one. Thomas the Tank Engine.